me continue with the following topic, and that's about our sensorless capability to drive the brushless DC motors. This morning you saw that we have a support for different types of sensors, current reading, topologies, speed sensors, position sensors, but especially when speaking about external sensors, they are expensive. Not only because you need to pay for the sensors, you need to pay for cables, for connectors, for space on the PCB, and so on. So if you have a choice to use a sensorless algorithm that doesn't need any extra wires, doesn't need extra sensors, and improves the robustness of the system, the sensorless algorithm is the way to go. So let me show you how this sensorless mechanism works. First, when you drive the motor, you have three terminals connected to that. And the only thing you can measure and that you have available in the system is the currents and the voltages. There is nothing more you can measure and you can deliver to the motor. So you have to live with these parameters, and somehow you shall be able to simulate what physically happens in the motor. You should validate this, and you should extract useful things from this model. We have chosen historically a model of the Luenberger observer, which is present here, and it's called back EMF state observer. Why back EMF state observer? First, it gives you, as a result of intermediate calculations, the representation of the back EMF voltage from the motor, which is equivalent to the voltage inducted by the rotating rotor within the windings. And it gives you, as these two values, the information about the amplitude, which is effectively speed of the motor, and the phase, which is the position of the rotor that we need. Further, state observer means that it represents the physical state of the motor in terms of mathematical matrices and some calculations. When you look at it, you find out that the state observer takes as an input parameter exactly what I have spoke about. It's the current represented as a perpendicular I alpha I beta, so a rotating current. It as well takes as an input the voltage delivered to the output, to the power stage, from the previous step as V alpha V beta. And to have a scaling representation, it as well takes the bus voltage. So with these three parameters, with these three inputs, it takes the physical model of your motor with the inductance, resistance, electrical constant, and in an iterative loop, it tries to estimate the back EMF, and it tries to estimate or compare to the measured current. Because we give it an input, the voltage on the power stage, and we give it the output that it should as well simulate and compare. So it's able to lock itself on the measured current and adapt to it. And the back EMF is, let's say, intermediate state variable of the model, not a direct output. Further, we use the back EMFs and we process them to get our speed and the angle of the rotor, so electrical angle. And this comes in a second block. This is a block put on top of the state observer. And here we have two options. We have a PLL and a Cordic option. So if we look at the state observer, we can find out that it effectively represents the physical behavior of the motor, which means through the electrical constant, it calculates what is the transmission from the delivered energy to the output torque. It uses the resistance and inductance for the time constant of the integrator implemented inside. And it as well uses a loopback where it works like a regulator, self-adapting regulator, from the currents that are estimated at this point and measured at this point. And this is added with some feedback back to the beginning of the model. So advantage of the Luenberger observer is that it's self-adapting. But to work properly, it needs to know something about the motor, which is the inductance, resistance, electrical constant. So, speaking about the transformations, you can begin with, for example, voltages inducted on the coils, and you can build a complete model of your electrical motor. And coming from the known parameters and the model of the motor, we can come to the results that are quite a lot of simplified, that at the end give us state variables representing the back EMF. With every PWM cycle, the microcontroller reads the currents and at the same time, it takes the voltages from the previous step. This is what we put on the power stage on the space vector modulation block. These voltages are the input to the motor. Motor reacts on a delivered voltage, right? So the model takes the same voltage and processes that within its physical representation of the motor. The outcome of this state observer model is the current flowing through the windings. So at the same time, I read the real current, which gives me the difference, that gives me a verification of my assumptions of the model. So when I calculate the difference between the two, I can react on the errors, on the differences between the calculation and the reading. And through a feedback coefficient, I can adapt the speed of reaction and the dynamics of the model. At the same time, this parameter in the real model called G or C2 parameter, and you will see it during debugging of your algorithms quite often, you give it a bandwidth because it works like a regulator effectively. And the bandwidth has a very important features for the debugging, because if the bandwidth is too high, the reading of the current brings some noise. The calculation is as well not perfect. So here, at this point, you would see quite a lot of noise. If you amplify the noise too much, what happens is that the model will be unbalanced and the regulation, the estimation of the angle, won't be smooth. So if you dump the error signal reasonably so that it's still able to lock itself on the physical properties of your motor, but it doesn't react too much on the random noise, it gives you much better results. Part of the internal variables of the motor model are the back EMFs. So when we complete the Leuenberger observer model, we calculate one step. This step will give us as two internal variables the E alpha and E beta. You can read how they are calculated. So through the flux, through the number of pole pairs, the speed of the rotor, and the sinus and cosinus of the angle. So the most straightforward method of extracting the angle that we use for the FOC loop, for the park transformation and inverse park transformation, is to take the two values and make an arcustangent of that. This is the most straightforward method. Unfortunately, it has drawbacks. And the drawback is that especially if E alpha is very small and nears to zero, you'll see that it becomes really sensitive to the noise. So at that point, you know that the reading is current reading is noisy. It has got a limited resolution, 16 bits. So when it comes to this calculation, the result of the arcustangent is unusable, because you cannot guarantee in quite a big range of angles that this won't create any troubles. So using arcustangent is a no-go. That's why our engineers in Catania, when they created the library many years ago, they came with the closed loop regulator that takes the model of the PI regulator and the integrator, and that works as a closed loop that tries to match its output, the angle with the sinus and cosinus, as close as possible to the E alpha and E beta created by the Leuenberger observer. It has got one disadvantage, which is quite small. The disadvantage of this model is that because it contains a time constant, it needs a little time for locking on your signal. And this time constant as well creates a limitation in the bandwidth. So it has got a limited speed of estimation. On the other side, it can be tuned and it doesn't normally bring any issues. And then come the advantages. Thanks to the time constant intrinsic to this loop, and thanks to the fact that it adapts to both signals independently of their amplitude, it's very stable and gives you a very good approximation of the angle and of the speed. So it's very reliable And if you don't have a crazy motor that really changes the speed really quickly, it's a perfect way of reconstructing the angle and the speed at the same time. PLL PI is available if I enable manual editing in the dialog box of the speed position feedback management. So if you want, you can tune it manually, but normally the workbench pre-calculates these values in a really reasonable way. One additional thing, when I spoke about the feedback parameter within the Luenberger, the K, you can find it in the same dialog box as the G2 parameter. If you work later in a runtime, you will see the same parameter called C2. I don't know why in the workbench it has two representations, but it's the same value, and simply by reducing it, you are reducing the influence of the error and you are dumping sensitivity to the noise. At the same time, of course, you are dumping the bandwidth of the Luenberger, but it can really help. For example, if in this case it was pre-calculated to 21,000, you can divide by 2, by 3, by 4, and you can really come to values of, for example, 2000. If the current reading is too noisy, this parameter can be reduced quite a lot. So, the PLL is one of the two options that we use for the sensorless algorithm. The second one is a Cordic. Cordic was implemented on a request of one customer that wanted to try it. So we found it useful and we implemented it. Cordic is, let's say, a simplified or algorithmically simplified version of the arcus tangent. So it gets two values and with a predefined number of steps with a bit shift and multiplication, so it's very cheap for implementation in software or in FPGAs. It's able to approximate the angle, and this is the result of the Cordic. By number of iterations, you predefine the precision, and you can see that with each single step, it comes closer to the given input values. So if you, for example, stop at the iteration number 8, you see that the maximum difference in the angle is 0.2 degrees. If you iterate further, and if the precision of the calculation allows, you can improve the precision even more. So this is kind of arcus tangent for us, with a little bit more reliable result. Anyway, because it doesn't give you any intrinsic filtering, it's still influenced by the noise. So it can give you quite a big angle steps, angle jumps during the estimation, which doesn't represent what really happens in the motor. So at the end, we still need to apply some small smoothing filter at the end of the Cordic. Then the Cordic has, you choose it as the option for the main or auxiliary sensor, a different set of settings. Okay. Now, there is a question how the state observer works during startup. When you start your motor, at the moment when you start it, the observer doesn't give any useful information. And it doesn't give it up to the approximately 5% of your nominal speed. So below that, the information from the observer, it's a physical limitation, it's a limitation of the hardware design, it's a limitation of the resolution of the variables. So if you use 16 bits, then you know that there will be a lot of digital noise in calculations. So there is a reasonable limit of 5 to 10% of your nominal motor speed where you can't use it. And that's why you need to help yourself during startup with some other method. We have chosen to use a forced startup with an open loop approach. What that means, you prepare the acceleration ramp, you prepare a current to frequency curve, and you simply start it. And you expect that at low speed, the motor will be able to stick to the accelerating magnetic vector, and it will accelerate along. And during this time, you will take the measured current and the voltage applied to the space vector, and you put it in the Luenberger observer. So the startup has two tasks. First one is physically start spinning. And the second one is to collect enough data so that the Luenberger observer can lock and start delivering useful information. And during this startup, we measure how the Luenberger observer gives reliable data. And if they are reliable enough, we consider it a good startup and then close the loop and give the control to the observer instead of the forced startup or forced speed ramp. That's how we do it. So it's open loop, you generate accelerating ramp, and when you consider the startup valid, you close the loop. There are two possibilities for the startup setup. You have got the basic one and you have got advanced one. The basic one gives you a simple acceleration ramp. The red one is the speed. So it goes from zero to the preset speed. The blue one is the current. So you can see that there is as well one additional point turned on, and this is the alignment. You normally apply a DC vector in the winding with a fixed vector and increasing size, increasing amplitude of the current. And this builds the magnetic field in the stator, and the rotor tries to lock to this position. Because when you stop the motor, you don't know where it is at the moment when you want to restart it. So what do? You apply a permanent magnet, and your rotor will lock to this position. There is, however, a little trouble. The trouble is that locking to this position can be difficult. If the motor is very light, so if you have got a reasonably small load, it will accelerate very quickly and it can overshoot the position and come back, and then it will stabilize around this position through vibrations. On the other side, if the load is too heavy, it can happen that it will not reach this position in a correct time. And if the load is even heavier, it may not be able to align at all. Typical case would be a compressor. If you have a fridge and you stop driving the motor, with its inertia, it will move towards the higher resistance when it pressurizes the air or the liquid in the with the piston. And as the pressure inside rises, it will become higher than the pressure of the pump itself, and the pump will stop. And now, if you want to align to the direction of the higher pressure, you simply don't have enough torque, so you won't be able to do that. And that's why we came with advanced startup that allows us not to define just a single ramp or single alignment, but it allows us to define up to 5 steps where we can play with the currents, with the speeds. We can define a zero speed with a negative current or vice versa. So the purpose of the advanced startup is that you can, for example, turn and align the motor backwards. For the pump, this has a very interesting result, because instead of pushing against the higher pressure, you can release the pressure. When you turn backwards, you are decreasing the pressure, so you are moving the piston backwards. And then, when you start real acceleration, you are coming over much smaller pressure, and when you gain some inertia, you can overcome the highest pressure peak, and when you gain more, you don't feel it anymore. So the advanced startup can help you in these situations when the startup could be too heavy. Further, when it comes to acceleration, you have to always adapt the current and the acceleration rate to a given load. Why? If the motor tries to accelerate too slowly, if the load is too heavy, it can happen that the speed is reached imposed too early and you lose the track of the motor, so it stalls. This typically means that the speed at the end of the ramp is too high, or that the current that you deliver to the motor is too low, so that you are not able to deliver enough energy for the proper acceleration. So you always have to tune the startup a little bit manually. The motor profiler helps you with that task, but if you do it manually, it's a little playing with the two parameters, current strength and the maximum speed or acceleration. So let's look at the different steps of the startup and where you can find them in the startup parameters. So the first thing is acceleration in the basic startup procedure. We can see that the startup begins with a zero speed, and we define duration of the speed ramp, and we define the final value of the speed ramp. These two parameters give us the acceleration, fixed acceleration applied to the motor. This is depicted as speed ramp duration in milliseconds and final value in RPM. Further, we have to think about how much energy we deliver to the motor. It's expressed in current, in amps, but it reflects the VF curve. So at the beginning, you probably don't need a really high current, but at the end, the current should be big enough to give the boost to the inertia of your motor and the load. These values are depicted here: current ramp initial value, current ramp final value, and the duration of the current ramp at the beginning. Normally, you can start with the current that's, let's say, one half, one third of your nominal current of the motor to give it really a reliable boost at the beginning. If it's not enough, you can set it up to the nominal current. Further, if we look at the advanced ramp, we have different stages. We have up to five stages. And in each of them, we define the end point with the duration, the final speed, and the final current. So we can play with the ramps independently for the current, for the speed. We can define negative speeds, negative currents. So this depends on us. And the question is how we estimate that our startup is reliable. Because there are no speed sensors that would tell us, okay, now the observer and the PLL or Cordic give us a good speed and good angle estimation. We have to use other methods. And for that, we have developed a statistical method to create or to calculate the reliability. So we take our feedback from the observer and from the PLL, and we put it in the speed buffer. So we have got estimation of the speed from the observer. We put it in the speed buffer. This has typically 64 items, but we can choose by any number of powers of two. So it can be 32, can be 128. 64 is a, let's say, good length, but for systems with higher dynamics, the length of the buffer needs to be reduced, for example, to 32. This is because if you accelerate slowly, then for the 64 compared to the normal speed, we have got a reasonable distribution of the speed. But if we accelerate very quickly and we calculate the statistics from that, we see that against the average speed, we have got a very high variation. So if we reduce the length of the buffer, the variation will be smaller. So we can play with length of the buffer and we can avoid unnecessary errors in our design. So how this works, during the startup, we read the speed estimation, we put it in the speed buffer, we calculate the average value of the speed in the buffer, and we calculate the variance, the statistical variance that can be calculated this way. And we compare this speed variance with a maximum factor that we allow. And if the speed variance is wider than expected, we consider it as a non-valid result. If the variance, and normally it's narrowing, when it's considered valid within the limits we set up for the startup, then we validate the startup as a good one. So the comparison is done here. We have got a parameter called variance threshold, and we use it to compare the mean value squared times variance threshold against the calculated variance. The variance threshold can be as well set up in the speed, position, and feedback management in the variance threshold field here. Normally, it's set to quite a small value, 6%. This value is good for detection of the motor stall, because if the motor is stalled, then the variance is typically higher. But for a startup estimation and validation, especially when you begin with a new motor, you can increase it up to 50% or even more to give you a trial to see, hey, we can turn the motor, we can close the loop, and it works. But at the end, the target of the speed variance threshold is to tune the proper startup, to tune the Leuenberger observer dynamics, and reduce the variance threshold as much as possible. Because when you are sure that your motor starts reliably, the second step is to use the same thing to validate that there are no issues with the motor, rotor locked. So as soon as you have a validated and good startup debugged, reduce this parameter as much as possible. When we validate the startup and in runtime as well the variance of the motor, this is not only not the only parameter that we can use for a good validation. Because the motors, when we, for example, load them too much, when they lose track of the rotating magnetic field, they stop, they stall. But if the magnetic field still spins around, if the rotor, if it's not really firmly fixed, it has got a very nice idea of oscillating around the stalled position. So it oscillates and the stator still rotates around. Trouble with this situation is that from the current reading, because it normally oscillates at the same frequency of spinning, the current reading gives you a perfectly reliable speed estimation telling you, hey, the motor rotates, everything's correct, and it is not. So the vibration is a really nasty thing for detection. Because frequency-wise, it's still perfect. It vibrates at the correct speed, so the current readings are as well correct. So there is, it's quite difficult from the statistical point of view to find this, if not impossible. However, we have a method to detect this, and that's the second reliability check in run mode. When the motor vibrates, when it doesn't spin like usual, how big is the back EMF? It's much smaller. So if we use the trick that we have got the back EMF estimation calculated from the currents, we see the real result because we adapt the real current reading. So our amplitude of the back EMF coming from the observer gives us the information about the real speed. On the other side, I've got the estimated speed coming from the vibration, which gives us an seemingly a good result. So I take the speed, I multiply it by electrical constant of the motor, I multiply it by some tolerance or consistency gain, and I bring it to the comparison. And now I compare the back EMF read from the motor and the back EMF estimated for a given speed. And if they differ by more than a given consistency tolerance, I know there is something wrong. Because the motor should spin at a given speed, it should give me a given back EMF amplitude. But the back EMF amplitude is much smaller, so it doesn't spin, it vibrates. This second method is used only if you change the consistency tolerance. Normally, it's set to 100%, so this test is bypassed. But if you set it to a lower value, you can activate this test, and I recommend it. Again, it's available in the speed and position feedback management dialog box. Alternative to this is that the SDK gives you a power estimation block. So if you read the power delivered to the motor, you will find out that for the rotor stalled, the power is much smaller. So if instead of expected 200 watts in your load, it gives you 2 or 3 watts, you know you have an issue. So the power estimation can be as well used for the same principle. In fact, it comes from the same parameters. Let's come back to the startup procedure, because that's not the only way of validating the startup. You know, the Leuenberger observer can, for example, detect the speed too early, and it may not be reliable enough. So we have a couple of other parameters that need to be fulfilled to validate our startup. So the first one is the consistency or variance threshold. Second one is that the estimated speed is within limits of the forced speed. So I am setting to the motor 550 RPM. I am expecting that the observer will give me something between 540 and 560. If the speed is different, if it's out of these bounds, it's not a valid reading. So we need to wait a little longer for the Leuenberger to lock. So this is the second thing, and the lower and higher limit is expressed in percent of the imposed speed. At the same time, we know that below a certain speed, let's say below these 5%, it's really unreliable to use the observer. So we as well set up a minimum speed to exit the open loop. And that means that the algorithm will wait at least to this imposed speed, then it will validate the estimated speed and it will validate the variance, and only then it will say, now I have got a valid reading, let's close the loop. Additionally, this test has to be applied for n consecutive times, 2 or 3, because if it's just one random reading that looks good, it's not enough. So we give it typically 2 consecutive readings, and then everything seems good. How to set it up? In the startup parameters, you say consecutive successful startup output tests. This is the N. Minimum startup output speed is this one. The estimated speed band tolerance upper limit is this one. And lower limit is this one. Plus variance threshold is in the sensor parameters. You can see where these parameters come from and what they mean. Now, I'm coming to the point where we have or we may have a startup issue. This typically happens when you have quite a light load, because when you impose a magnetic field in the stator and the rotor follows and it has a light load, as you increase the current and then the current is maintained at some value, how far is the rotor, the vector of the rotor, from the vector of the statoric field? Not far at all, because it's very light, so it can very easily follow. So the distance can be, for example, 15-20 degrees. So with this angle, 15-20 degrees, what is the efficiency of the energy transfer? It's very low, because the sinus of the vectorial multiplication is small by sinus of this angle. And at the moment when you close the loop, it will switch over to the angle estimated by the observer. So what happens then? You are imposing 90 degrees at the same current. What happens? Yes, exactly at this moment, you can several times increase the torque. So you were accelerating with some torque because of low efficiency. And suddenly, by changing the control angle, you impose three times higher torque. So what happens with the motor? It starts accelerating like hell. And at this moment, because we are still evaluating statistically whether the speed estimation is good and has a low variance, if I have got, for example, this speed acceleration and then suddenly it goes this way, at this moment, the variance will not fulfill the condition. And our algorithm says, sorry guys, it's not a reliable speed reading, let's stop. So at that point, you get a speed feedback error. So what to do now? We have got the possibility to counteract this effect. And that's exactly with the rev up to FOC switchover. This is an algorithm that changes the current from the imposed one to the one estimated by the observer fluently with a given duration. So if you activate it, it takes the current imposed at the moment of closing the loop and starts applying slowly in a ramp the current imposed by the, let's say, control loop. So this way, I'm going from the forced current to the regulated current slower, which in many cases helps. On the other side, we know two types of motors, ones that like this switch over and ones that hate it. So you have to try, if you get this error, whether to turn it on or off. Unfortunately, we tried different methods like calculating the efficiency of the motor control and changing fluently the angle or changing the current or imposing other currents, and it's not that reliable. So this simple method seems for now the best one. And it allows to control the acceleration quite efficiently. Let's move to this picture. This is a very nice picture that is measured with the current probe and two outputs of the DAC that are driven by the library. So you can see a really nice startup with all the parts of it perfectly adjusted. So when we look at the beginning, we can see that the current is rising up for the alignment. Further, it imposes the ramp with acceleration. And you can see that the observed back EMF, one of the two back EMF signals, first isn't really nice, but then it becomes better and better. Same thing with the observed electrical angle. At the beginning, it's quite rough. It has got steps in that. And as the speed increases, the readout of the angle, the calculation of the angle, becomes smoother and smoother. So exactly at this point, the startup was validated and we closed the loop. So what happened? Because this is a speed mode, it started the acceleration and wanted to reach 5000 RPM. So what it did, you can see that the speed algorithm increased the current to full one and it lets the motor accelerate to these 5000 RPM. As soon as we reach the speed, the regulation algorithm decreases the current and maintains it only so that it covers the losses and keeps the motor spinning at 5000. Additionally, you can observe that the back EMF here gives you some estimation. It a little bit increases as the motor accelerates. But as soon as we turn to the closed loop and we use the speed regulator, the back EMF amplitude increases and the frequency as well increases. So you can see a perfect representation of the back EMF calculated in the motor. This is physically correct. And this is just to represent that the angle calculation works well. We would need to zoom to see the details, but it would still be the saw. So this startup is a really, really nice representation of a good response well-tuned system. So remember it and make your designs this way. The MTPA was developed to support motors with a brushless DC characteristics. These motors are trapezoidal, so their response of the back EMF is not a sinusoidal one. And you can see that thanks to the fact that it has got the reluctance torque added on top of the synchronous torque. So this is the equation for the torque in the motor. And because for such motors, you can identify two different inductances, the minimum and maximum one, which are perpendicular to each other and reflect different currents. When you simplify the equation, you can put it so that the torque relies on the quadrature current, and there is a swell part that relies both on quadrature and magnetization current. And this one, because the two currents have the same frequency, but multiplication brings a double frequency, it brings a ripple in the torque. When we look further, the MTPA tries to use this reluctance torque and adapt the control strategy for better efficiency. So we can continue further with the expression of the current torque, and we can find out that the first parameter is equal to the sinus omega or epsilon with the same frequency, but then we have got the reluctance torque with a double frequency. Now, if we put both torques on the same chart, the synchronous torque, the blue one, and the reluctance torque, the red one, we can find out that if we sum both torques together, it will create the yellow result. And because we want to control the maximum torque transfer from the delivered energy to the motor, we will look at the total torque. And that means that if we want to transfer maximum energy, we will not do it at 90 degrees, but we will do it a little bit further. So if we have a motor with a reluctance torque, which means trapezoidal shape of the back EMF or different inductances in the windings that we can identify, we can calculate this phase shift, and the phase shift changes with the amplitude of the current, because here is the influence linear and here is the influence quadrature. So at the end, when we calculate the angle change, we can calculate it for different points of the current from zero up to the full nominal current. And from the value of the two inductances, we can identify the phase shift between these points. So if I increase, for example, the current to 50%, I get the phase shift of, I don't know, 110 degrees. If I calculate it to nominal, I get 130 degrees. So this depends mainly on the ratio between the LD and LQ. Then we can play a little bit further in different coordinate systems, and we can calculate the torque versus ID, torque versus IQ. And at the end, we will linearize this calculation. It's pre-calculated by the motor control workbench. It gives you several points pre-calculated by the workbench, and it lets the algorithm and TPA algorithm linearize between these points. So at the end, when we enable the MTPA, it will prepare a table for us, and the table will be applied on the demagnetization current, depending on the value of the quadrature current. So this way, with increasing current, it will change the angle, and this implements better torque transfer or optimum torque transfer. The algorithm is allowed only when you have a motor with a different LD and LQ. If they are equal, this algorithm is not present and you can't turn it on. So the table here gives you a performance. So simply by clicking that you want the MTPA, you can gain the efficiency. It's like a magical button. Yesterday, we spoke about flux weakening in terms of the physics in the motor. The principle is that if we have some spare torque, we can exchange it for the demagnetization of the permanent magnet on the rotor and increase the speed, because we reduce the effective electrical constant. So the flux weakening is used for extending the speed range. And in some cases, it can be as well used for smoothing the regulation at the end of your speed range. Because what it does, it reduces the torque, it reduces the strength. And if you still have some available torque at the end of the speed range, the regulator can unbalance it. So when you reach the maximum speed, it can start vibrating and the result is not really nice. So applying flux weakening can help you either to overcome the maximum electrical speed or to smoothen the regulation at the end. So typically, flux weakening is used in applications like washing machines or air conditioning, and it operates on the back EMF. How the back EMF or flux weakening works from the FOC control principle. Normally, when we regulate the motor, we regulate the torque. So we maintain IQ constant on some value equivalent to the torque we need. But we keep the ID, the demagnetization current, at zero, because changing it from zero eats from our current budget. In case of demagnetization, we get or we impose a negative ID current, and the negative ID current works against the vector of the rotor magnetic field. So it simply subtracts in a vectorial way and reduces the effective effect on the statoric winding. So by this, our solution allows to increase the nominal speed. Okay, we have tested 5 times nominal speed, which is quite a lot. But still think about the multiplication factor when you reset the microcontroller. 320 volts times 5, quite a lot. So, the flux weakening is suitable for both motors with internal permanent magnets and surface-mounted permanent magnets. So, the ones with the reluctance torque, the ones without reluctance torque. Our algorithm doesn't require the knowledge of the system because it uses a closed-loop approach. So, it self-adapts. And because the speed control relies on the bus voltage. If we use the flux weakening, we use the readout of the bus voltage to compensate against the effects of dropping of the supply voltage. The block diagram of the flux weakening is imposed here. You can see that it takes the input of the bus voltage here. It puts it into the regulation loop, which is expressed here as a PI controller. And at the same time, it takes the voltages from the FOC regulator. It calculates their absolute value, the amplitude of the voltage. Compares it against the available bus voltage, and that is used for changing the ID. So effectively how this works, let's imagine that you are running your system at 320 volts, standard supply from mains, rectified mains. Then you apply a given speed to your motor. This is effectively expressed in some voltage on the windings, 200 volts. Do I need flux weakening at 200 volts? Not at all. So I increase the speed. I increase it to 300. Do I need flux weakening here? No. So I increase it further and I increase it to the level of the V-bus and approximately 97% of the V-bus. So this is 310 volts. At this level, the flux weakening starts operating. You can set up in percent at which level the flux weakening operates. So if the voltage calculated from the power stage reaches 97% of my V-bus, it starts thinking, it starts calculating, what if I need a higher voltage? So it starts demagnetizing. You can see that there is the integrator that calculates from the requested voltage and from the available voltage how much I need to integrate. The limiter then calculates the ID. You know that the demagnetization works only for the negative values of ID, so the limiter cuts everything above. And if there is still a higher request for the phase voltage, it integrates more. If there is a lower request, it integrates less or again returns the integrator back to zero. So the outcome is that if I need more voltage for acceleration, equivalent to the higher speed, it starts demagnetizing. If I drop the speed, it returns back the integral constant here. And then it sums it with the result of the MTPA limits again. Then it applies as well the limit to IQ because it must not overcome the nominal current of the motor. And then these newly calculated currents are applied to the FOC model. So thanks to this fact that I'm calculating the requested phase voltage versus the available voltage and I'm using the integrator here, I can adapt to any speed I want, and if there is enough torque, the demagnetization will work. If there is not enough torque, the speed will drop down and the regulation will return to zero. So it will find some midpoint where it trades off between the demagnetization and the available torque. So effectively, when you apply flux weakening, you have to define at which voltage level it starts acting. The default case is 97%. And then the rest is the PI coefficients for the flux weakening regulator. One thing here, time constants. The flux weakening regulator should be much slower than the speed regulator. If their time constants would be similar, they would move from one to the other and you will see very nasty oscillations. Now, when you activate the flux weakening, you can see that it's one of the additional methods or advanced methods. And when it's activated, it gives you P and I coefficients and the voltage limit. So these are the parameters that you need to tune for the flux weakening to work properly. Then otherwise, you can observe it in real time and see how it works. Because when you run it in runtime, you can see bus voltage allowed and measured. And when they match, flux weakening will start demagnetization, so you will see it on the ID ref current. Additionally, with the older library with the GUI, you could as well tune it on the display. With version 4.3 and the ST eval boards, you had this graphical interface available, so in runtime you could change it directly on your eval board. So you can see the performance of the flux weakening. So in this case, we are using a motor that runs at 5 times nominal speed. And what is really interesting, at this speed, we have got 13 FOC / PWM cycles per each electrical rotation. So it's really rough regulation and it still works very well. And you can see further the voltages, the currents, the control, the phase, measurement of the DC bus and the regulation changes. So let's speak about the feedforward. This algorithm is normally again used as a algorithm that helps you to improve the efficiency in case of high CPU load and, for example, high speeds or high reaction, high dynamics of your system. The theory of the feedforward is that while the loopback system typically reacts after the change happens and tries to regulate it back. So the closed loop always reacts with a delay, which is sometimes unwanted behavior. Sometimes you want to react immediately. And that's exactly the method of feedforward. The feedforward mechanism reacts or can pre-calculate immediate change. For example, if you drop a supply voltage and you want to maintain the constant speed. Normally, once you drop the supply voltage, the microcontroller, or the power stage, will as well drop the effective voltage on the motor, and the motor will immediately start decelerating, and the speed loop will take some milliseconds to react on that, and then it will take another milliseconds to come back to this speed. So a closed loop will give you the effect, but it will give it late. While feedforward sees, hey, I have got a drop in the supply voltage, that means that if it dropped by 20 volts, I need this torque to give it back, to maintain the same speed. So it knows 20 volts at this speed means this amount of current. Let's put it immediately on the output to compensate. So the advantage is that it reacts almost immediately. A little disadvantage is that you need to understand what you are doing. You have to make a quantization of your model. You have to understand what is the inertia of your load, what are the parameters of your motor. So it needs quite a lot of parameters. We have got such system implemented. It uses the parameters you put in the motor model. It can compensate especially the drops in the bus voltage. Where this is useful, if you have, for example, a system with two motors, where one is accelerating and one is decelerating. Then the feedforward can compensate for changes of the bus voltage immediately. So the reaction of such system is then much better. Feedforward effectively can help specifically if you have several motors, and it can help with the cross coupling, with the back EMF cancellation, and it's implemented here on top of the FOC model. So it takes the bus voltage, it takes the speed, and it compensates for the feedforward current regulation and bus voltage, adding its output together with the current regulation, so giving you the request for the stator voltages. And we normally suggest to turn it on only if we have some harsh conditions or regulation conditions that are difficult, like a very fast motor operation when we have small amount of PWM periods per electrical cycle. Because in this case, we don't have enough time for proper regulation, so feedforward will improve the efficiency. The parameters of the feedforward are calculated within the motor control workbench, and it doesn't allow tuning. Another effect or another algorithm used inside the SDK is a circle limitation algorithm. This is intrinsically implemented to all voltage commands to the stator, and they effectively scale the voltage request from our control algorithm from the FOC loop to the available bus voltage. So the scaling ratio, the maximum modulation index, this is a constant, and this voltage are pre-calculated from the nominal voltage of the model that we included in the MC workbench. And it gives us a scaling factor for VQ and VD. And when the circle limitation is applied, it effectively takes the ratio of the VD and VQ requested from the FOC model. It multiplies it with the precalculated factor, and the result is then sent to the space vector modulation scheme. So effectively, the circle limitation is a thing that is able to scale down the voltage requests from full range to the available voltage. It's implemented automatically, precalculated by the workbench applied in the SDK. Further algorithm I'd like to speak about is a space vector modulation. There exist several different methods how to bring up the three-phase voltage on the phases. The first one, if you want a rotating field at the outputs of your power stage, how would you do it? So we can think about different ways of modulation of the motor, and we can boost the energy transfer to the motor by modulating center voltage. So if I modulate it with cleverly designed shape, I am able to bring, for example, 7-10% of the energy more, because I gain the voltage by shifting the central point. The space vector modulation is one of the algorithms that allows this. And you can see that for different angles from 0 to 360 degrees, it can split these angles by 60 degrees and then bring you a shape that looks like this. This is a voltage on one of the phases, this is a voltage on, in this case, phase A, and this is a linear transition for phase B. So when you look at this 60 degrees cut, it's very easily implemented. This is a sinus table, this is a sinus table inverted, this is a linear transition. So calculating such output is really easy. Additionally, this is not a pure sinus, but this is a sinus with third harmonics. Because this way I'm able to boost the energy or the voltage by, I think, approximately 3% more. Additionally, injecting third harmonics in voltage will increase the effective voltage on the motor, but it will cancel in the current. So the current will still be beautifully sinusoidal without the third harmonics seen in the current. So by preparing a table with third harmonics and applying it this way, of course scaling it depending on the duty cycle, I can implement the output very easily, and this is how we do it. So you know what are the boundaries for the current reading, where there are limitations for the current reading for ADCs. You can, for example, imagine that at this point where both voltages here are very close to each other, you have got an issue reading the current. Same situation happens here. In the middle, it's rather easy. But if, for example, you are working with a very small duty cycle, when all voltages come closer, then again, you start having problems reading the currents. So depending on the phase within each of these six steps, the algorithm inside doesn't only generate the proper duty cycles, but it as well generates a proper time and the proper input for ADC to read the currents. So the control block that takes care about the space vector modulation generates both duty cycles and proper sampling times and proper sampling inputs at the same time.